Hi, I'm Pure Excellence, the most important political mind this side of the United States. But let's just explore this idea. I'm going to pass it to my homeboy, James. James, go ahead and take this away.
Hey, the Stimulus Lighthouse Alert Community presents Donald Trump's Long History of Lawsuits Part 1. There's a common saying about claims, the only real winners are the attorneys. That's due to the fact that nearly all legal fights are lengthy and unpleasant for the wallets, credibilities, and mental well-beings of everybody included. In this context, claims are thought about by lots of people to be dramatic and psychological affairs, as demonstrated by popular films on the subject such as Philadelphia and Aaron Brockovich. Nevertheless, the truth is that lawsuits is seldom as interesting as represented in the movies. The huge majority of lawsuits are uninteresting, unpleasant, and irrelevant for all, however, a handful of individuals. In spite of the overwhelming negativity that originates from claims, they've just end up being a more and more popular practice in America. This can be seen in the constant growth of working attorneys in the nation, given that the late 1800s, the growing salaries of attorneys, and in the increased costs on litigation by large companies over the last few years. Aside from service suits and federal claims, legal action among individuals in civil court has also been on the rise over the past 30 years, from around 460,000 cases in 1990 to over 650,000 in 2018, according to information from United States courts. Whether it's huge organization, entertainment, politics, or specific grievances, litigation has long been thought about among America's preferred pastimes. What better method to show this long-standing trend than by taking a look at the comprehensive legal history of the most effective male in the country? Aside from organization suits and federal lawsuits, legal action amongst individuals in civil court has likewise been on the increase over the previous 30 years, from around 460,000 cases in 1990 to over 650,000 in 2018. Trump's lawsuits, the greatest hits. Donald J. Trump, the 45th President of the United States, has actually been associated with over 4,000 legal fights in some capability. From his beginnings in the property and gambling markets throughout the 70s and 80s, to his entrepreneurial and entertainment endeavors in the 90s and early 2000s, all the way to his baffling transition into politics in the 2010s, Trump has actually been battling courthouse fights every step of the method. Prior to going any even more, here's a quick disclaimer: this piece is indicated to be academic and is not a politically determined attack on the president. Whether or not Trump has actually committed any misdeeds or is culpable for any misdeeds is not the point of this piece. Instead, the goal here is to utilize his history to comprehend the reality of lawsuits and how they typically take place in different American markets. Also, this video will not go over all 4,000 plus lawsuits in which he's been involved. That's just not possible. Rather, let's take a look at some of Trump's highest profile cases with the best academic value. Trump's real estate lawsuits. Trump real estate lawsuits. Before becoming an entertainment magnate and politician, Donald Trump started his career in 1968 at his father's New York-based property business. He ended up being the company's president 3 years later on, calling it the Trump Organization. In his time as president of his company, he supervised lots of property bids, purchases, and projects, a number of which involved prolonged legal battles at the federal, state, and civil level. Here are a few of the notable cases Trump combated as a real estate magnate. 1973 to 1975, United States v. Fred C. Trump, Donald J. Trump and Trump Management Incorporated. Lawsuit against Trump by U.S. Justice Department. During the 70s, the main service tasks of the Trump Organization involved building and remodeling hotels, skyscrapers, and houses in New York City. Actions that were supposedly performed at a few of these properties led to a civil rights case against Trump, his father, and their business, with the United States Justice Department Civil Rights Division as the prosecution. This specific claim was filed in federal court instead of state or civil court. This is because of the reality that it included accusations of breaking civil liberties law, making it a federal concern. In specific, the plaintiff claimed the Trump Organization broke the Fair Housing Act of 1968, which forbids landlords and property business from making housing not available to persons based on elements such as their race, faith, disabilities, and similar criteria. According to a short article in the New York Times from the year in which the fit was submitted, the U.S. Justice Department claimed that the Trump Organization violated the Fair Housing Act due to the fact that they required various rental conditions since of race, in addition to misrepresenting to blacks that apartments were not readily available. According to official court files, Trump denied any discrimination, and his lawyer Roy Cohn relocated to dismiss the case due to an absence of considerable evidence. Moreover, He likewise filed a counterclaim based upon damage to Trump's track record due to the above New York Times article, requesting $100 million from the U.S. federal government in damages. Winner, draw. This case was settled 2 years later. As part of the settlement, the Trump Organization was required to send lists of home vacancies to local civil liberties organization the New York Urban League. According to another New York Times post, the goal of this action was to allow the league to offer competent applicants for each fifth job in those Trump structures where blacks inhabit fewer than 10% of the apartments. Since this settlement didn't imply any regret on the part of Trump or his company, however, did require his business to act to encourage more diverse occupants, it can essentially be thought about a draw. 1982 to 1986, tenants of 100 Central Park South v. Donald J. Trump and Park South Associates, Trump lawsuit versus Central Park South tenants. One of the many New York real estate company endeavors that constructed Trump's track record included a 14-story apartment building at 100 Central Park South. Now relabeled Trump Park East, this used to be a rent-controlled home, which meant there were lots of occupants living there who paid far below the average rental expenses for that area. Naturally, this isn't an ideal circumstance for a landlord to be in, specifically if they're interested in renovating the whole residential or commercial property to increase its value, as Trump was. Lawsuit against Trump involving Park East. Image source, Zillow. The money outlines the prolonged legal fight that took place over this conflict of interest based on looking into the 2,895 various court documents associated with the case. Beginning with his purchase of the home in 1981, tenants alleged that Trump did everything in his power to force rent-controlled renters to move. A 1985 New York Times post lays out a few of the different strategies the 60-odd renters declared Trump took part in, which included threatening to destroy the residential or commercial property, taking legal action against private renters in civil court, limiting essential services like water and heat, disregarding to repair concerns with plumbing and water damage, employing spies to gather tenants' personal details, engaging in a psychological tug-of-war to wear the tenants down. Among Trump's alleged plans to vacate renters is described in another New York Times short article from 1983. Dripping with sarcasm, this piece explains how Trump intended on momentarily filling uninhabited homes with New York's homeless, apparently in the hopes of scaring away the other tenants. Nevertheless, the Human Resources Administration declined his Machiavellian deal, saying that it left them with an unpleasant sensation. This unusual episode was also consisted of in the occupants' legal problems. Winner, tenants. Although Trump would declare victory in his autobiography and in future conversations about the affair, it appears plain as day that the tenants were the real winners. As a 1986 New York Times short article describes it, a settlement was reached between both parties that ended all litigation. The occupants were permitted to continue living in the building with their regulated lease, and Trump would rather be refurbishing the existing structure rather than demolishing it. Trump likewise wound up paying $550,000 to the tenants' attorneys. Certainly, this sum isn't a huge offer to a billionaire. However, it's a concession that can definitely be seen as an admission of defeat. 1992 to 1997. Donald J. Trump and Mar-a-Lago Club Incorporated v. Palm Beach County, Trump against Palm Beach lawsuit. Although Trump's turbulent property profession is largely specified by his New York-based tasks, his 1985 acquisition of the historical Mar-a-Lago Resort in Palm Beach, Florida is equally significant to his East Coast efforts with regards to his tradition. Given that acquiring this home, many claims were filed by Trump versus the city in the 1990s, showcasing his hallmark service method of weaponized litigation. The lawfare started in 1992, when Trump decided he was going to convert the residential or commercial property into personal estates in order to lease them out and repay his exorbitant financial obligations. This move was obstructed by Palm Beach County, because they viewed the home as a long-standing historical landmark. As outlined in an article from the Palm Beach Post that year, Trump's reaction was to file a $50 million lawsuit accusing the county of conflicts of interest, personal conferences, special interest lobbying, and prejudiced board members. Another match was filed in 1995 by Trump implicating the county of bugging Mar-a-Lago visitors by directing air traffic over the property at low altitudes. An article from the Sun Sentinel chronicles this particular legal fight, which included an accusation from Trump that a judgmental county airport director was seeking revenge by assaulting Mar-a-Lago from the air. Trump's factor for believing that Palm Beach County was continuously maltreating him and his club was raised in yet another lawsuit filed in 1997. An archived article from the Wall Street Journal that same year describes how he filed a discrimination fit for $100 million, which claims the Mar-a-Lago was maltreated due to the fact that it is open to Jews and African Americans. Winner, Trump. After seeking advice from attorney Paul Rampell, Trump settled his 1992 suit by converting the Mar-a-Lago into a private club that is open to everyone. Although this seems like an oxymoron, what it meant in practice was that Trump might freely bring in rich individuals to join his club that didn't fit in with the remainder of the Palm Beach crowd. His 1995 air traffic suit was settled after convincing the county to rent him 215 acres of barren land in exchange, which ended up being a financially rewarding personal golf club. Finally, the 1997 discrimination suit led to most of the county's restrictions being raised, allowing him to run his private club as he saw fit. Ultimately, all of these claims directed at Palm Beach County in the 90s resulted in triumphs for Trump, even if the suits themselves ended in settlement offers. As a 2016 Vanity Fair short article recounted, these lawsuits served a cunning purpose to totally transform Palm Beach society in order to better suit his personal and professional ambitions. In reality, Trump went on to carry out a similar method in 2002 when acquiring and refurbishing a golf course in Rancho Palos Verdes, California.